Welcome to Hoops High, Chicago's leader in youth-produced sports broadcasting and youth media education. Hoops High is produced by high school students learning the skills of professional broadcasting. Hoops High is the flagship program of Free Spirit Media and is made possible in partnership with After School Matters, the Chicago Public Schools, and Chicago Access Network Television. We hope you enjoy the show.
Passes to number one. Number one is at the top of the key, dribbling the ball, and it was some type of, I think he had rubber bands on his wrist, so they told him to take it off. Number one gets the ball, passes to number six. Number six shoots a three-pointer, and he's in.
Great job.
Number zero, Tyrese Winford drives to the hole and shoots, he gets fouled. The foul is on the Heat, number six. Tyrese Winford is going to the line to shoot two free throws. Shoots the first one and it's in. He will be shooting for another free throw. And the second free throw is in. Horst dribbled the ball up the court. At the top of the key, passes the ball to number six. Number six passes back to number one. And he drives baseline. And the court's defense is very great. Number six shoots another three-pointer. And he misses. Number 23, Sean Lewis gets the rebound and passes up court. He pulls up for a three-pointer and misses. Prep defense, pass the ball to number one on the Heat. Number one passes the ball to number five shoots. And he misses. They called the ball hit the top of the rim, so they call it out of bounds. The court will be bringing the ball down. Foul, reaching foul on number one for the Heat.
Right now,
Miller
the
with
the time
foul.
Is 17:48. The score is 2-3.
Inbounds ball to number zero, Williford. Brings the ball up court, passes number 13, Mr. Dawson. Number one drives, Miller drives, and he misses the layup. Jump ball is called. Possession will go to the court. Referee get the call mixed up.
For Foreman Heat, the head coach is Henry Cotton. Three people to watch for is Clinton Miller, Jane King, and Tyrese Williford.
Pulls up for a three-pointer. Number six for the Heat gets the ball, passes number one. Number one pulls up for a three-pointer and it's off. Out of bounds on number 23, Mr. LaShawn Lewis. Oh, steal by number one, Mr. Miller. Number zero, Williford hits the layup. The Heat is bringing the ball down. Number one, Mr. Miller brings it down, sets up, passes the ball. 3-point shot is attempted and missed. Foul on number. Foul on the Heat, number five. Sixteen minutes to go in the first half. 4-3. The courts are up. Passes the ball to number 13. Number 13 passes back. At the top of the key.
You are watching Hoops High. Remember, you can watch Hoops High every Saturday at 8 o'clock p.m. on CAN TV, Channel 19, for all of the hottest high school sports action around.
it was a foul committed by the Heat. The Quest would inbound the ball. Pentron Miller would inbound the ball for the court. Sets up the inbound play. Passes the ball to number 21 for the court. James King, he turns it over. Gets the ball in the corner, passes the ball. Passes to number 6 for the Heat. Number 6 pulls up the 3-point shot, and it is good. Of course, bring the ball up, drives to the hole, and he lost the ball. He will be bringing the ball down.
Marshall Court. Keep out looking for the numbers 1, 0, and 21 throughout the game.
Pulls up. Good punch by number 6.
Time is 14:30. Score 4-6.
He will be taking the ball out from the baseline. Pass the ball to number 1, Mr. Miller. No, excuse me. Yeah, Mr. Miller. Number 0 brings the ball down, drives, kicks it back out. Oh, Mr. Number 21 tried to dunk the ball for the court. James P. Foul was committed by a Heat player.
Hoops High is produced by high school students who are learning the skills of professional broadcasting. All of the camera work, announcing, and directing engineer is done by students.
The first free throw is good. Second free throw is in there for the courts. The Heat bringing the ball down. Number 1. Pass the ball. Number 6. Pass it back. Number 6 at the top of the key. Passes. Pump fakes. Pass it back. Number 6 shoots the ball. And it is off. Rebound tipped in by number 3 for the Heat. 0 brings the ball up, drives, stops, pops, and he misses. Number 23 with the rebound, posts up, shoots, foul, and he would be going to the line for 2 free throws.
How you feel about the game so far, Marcus?
You know what, I think it's an interesting game so far. I mean, the courts have 2 big players, number 21 and 23, so if they wanted to, they would dominate the game. How do you feel about the game?
The game is going pretty far. Pretty good so far. A nice little lead, 2 points up.
Number 23 misses the first free throw. He will be shooting another free throw. And he hits the second free throw. The score now being 7-8, 12 minutes to go in the first half. Pass the ball to number 6 at the top of the key for the Heat. The Heat swings the ball to number 1. Number 1 pump fake, drives baseline, and shoots and misses.
Keep a lookout for number 10 in this game.
Pump fake again for number 6. Dishes the ball off in a layup. Foul on number 23 for the court. It looked like it would be a sub coming in the game for the court. Number 2 at the line for the Heat, shooting a free throw, and he misses. Number 23 for the courts, LaShawn Lewis is coming out the game. Roger Williams is now in the game, number 17 for the courts. Rebound by 21 for the courts. Passes the ball up court to number 0. Number 0 dishes to 21. 21 shoots the ball, misses. There was a foul committed by the courts. And it looked like the courts are pressing. Number 1 drives the ball up court, breaks the press. Pass the ball to number 6. Number 6 holds the ball at the wing. kicks back to number one. Drives to the hole and lays it up, and he missed the layup. Rebound by number two. The refs called jump ball. The ball would go back to the Heat. Heat inbounds the ball to number one. Number one dishes to number six. Number six drives. Turns the ball over. Number three brings it down. Oh, he lost the ball. Number 17 lays the ball up.
That was a great pickup.
The foul was committed by number one for the Heat.
The time is 9:48. The score is 9-8. Decent game so far.
Williams Pickens is at the line shooting two free throws. He hits the first free throw. Shoots the second free throw and he misses. Number five with the rebound for the Heat. He dribbles the ball, brings it up court, and losses the ball, but they retrieve the ball right back. Number six dribbling the ball. Foul committed on the play. Jabari Harris picks up a reach-in foul for the court.
Now we're going to talk to our sideline reporter.
Coach, I know you're here just spectating. What are your views on the game so far?
I think the game is going pretty good considering the competition as far as the school and the season being over with already, and these guys are getting prepared for next year. Looks pretty good.
So, Coach, now I know you are coaching for both a high school and Malcolm X.
Right.
So what are the key elements for a player to transition from high school to college?
Well, one of the things that we look for in the college level is education, number one, and then we try to find good people who really have the ability as well as want to learn what it takes to be a better person as well as a basketball player.
That sounds about right. So, Coach, just tell me, how's your day going so far?
Oh, my day's going absolutely great. I get to hang out in the gym and watch all this new talent that I hope to see on television in the next 5 to 10 years. Yeah, that's good.
Well, thanks, Coach. Thank you so much for your time.
All right, great. No problem.
Hi, and I'm going to toss it back now to the announcers.
Thank you, Jeanette, for a great interview. We're back in the game. The score is 12-10, 7 minutes and 30 seconds to go. The Heat has the ball. Passes to number 5. Number 5 passes to number 6. Number 6 drives baseline. Gets stopped. Great defense by the courts. Kicks it back out to reset. Drive all the way to the hole, and he misses the layup. Number 6 will be shooting 2 free throws.
Hoopside is the flagship program of Free Spirit Media, and it's run in partnership with After School Matters, the Chicago Public Schools, and Ken TV. This is a team effort all around, and we are grateful for our partners who made this possible.
Number 6 at the free throw for the Heat, shooting, and he hits. First free throw is good. Tight game here. He's shooting the second free throw. And he hits the second free throw.
Keep a lookout. The time is tied. 12-12 with 6:20 left on the clock.
Quest brings the ball up. Number 11 passes to number 21. Number 21 lays the ball up and misses. Rebound by number 5. Mr. Bowden, but he turns the ball over. The Heat will have the ball and they will be inbounding. Passes to number 17, Roger Williams. Roger Williams kicks it. Number 1 gets the ball. Miller shoots and he hits. That was a tough shot there. Mr. Bowen was all in his face.
The PSAs, drama, and documentaries that are used between breaks or hoops high are produced by Free Spirit Media students at North Lawndale College Preparatory High School and Gary Coleman Youth Center in Powerhouse High. We hope that you enjoy the stories and messages that young people are sharing.
It was a turnover by Williams for the Heat, and now Marshall, the course, I bring the ball up. Breaks the press, turns the ball over. Williams with a pass to number five for the Heat, lays the ball up. Christopher Bowden turns the ball over. Bowden with the rebound. Lays the ball in. Bowden with 2 quick points in 10 seconds. He will be going to the free throw line and shoot one. Foul on Tyrese Willington.
In the meanwhile, keep up with game action and the Hoops High crew with Twitter. Just search Hoops High FSM and follow us. Thank you.
He hits his free throw off the and one play. Of course, bring the ball down. Kicks it out, drives to the hole, and it's blocked. Williams kicks the ball down. Drives all the way to the hole, passes to Bowden. Bowden shoots the ball and misses. Over and back, it's called on Hort. And Marvin Hort with the over the back call.
You are watching Hoops High. We are at Golden Dome, where we have the Heat versus the Court. The score is now 14-17 with 3:56 left on the clock.
The Court turned the ball over. So Genesis, how do you feel so far about the game?
Well, the game is decent. You know, they go back and forth with the ball, some getting the lead, some staying the lead. You know, I'm not really sure which team I'm going for right now, but we'll just see by the end of the game.
Yeah, because he was losing by quite a bit, about like 6 points, and then now they have caught up and took the lead. Actually, they're winning by 3.
Yeah, they're doing good now.
Number 5, Amari Hurd turns the ball over. Of course, gets the ball, drives to the hole, and Bowen blocks the shot, but the referee calls jump ball. The Heat will get the ball because of the possession error. All right. He brings the ball up, number 11. Rice with the ball. Offensive foul called.
The time is 2:44.
17-14, the Heat is up. Number 0 drives the ball. Willie Fair passes the ball to number 23. Deshaun Lewis gets fouled on the layup. He will be going to the line to shoot 2 free throws.
That he has many free throws throughout the game. That's why they're up in the game now.
The first free throw is good. Deshaun Lewis will be shooting a second free throw. The Heat brings the ball down. Passes the ball, kicks it back out. Tight defense by the Courts. Crossover.
The key player for the Heat is Christopher Bowen, number 5. Keep a lookout throughout the game.
Turns the ball over. The Heat turns it over. Passes. Oh, turnover. Roger Williams with the turnover.
That was a far pass he threw.
He just needed to make a basic pass, and it was a good layup for Deshaun Lewis. He brings the ball up. Danielle Williams brings the ball up, kicks it out to Bowen. Bowen with the crossover pass. Buffet, oh, he jumps over his head. Good block. Number 13 for the Court brings it down. Oh, he lays the ball up. I thought it was a dunk there.
Also, keep a lookout from Marshall, which is Jersey White. Christopher Miller, number one.
Close game here, 18-17.
The clock is ticking, 18-17, with 36 left on the clock.
So how do you feel about the first half, Vincent?
Well, I'm still iffy, but so far it's a good game. I enjoy it.
I mean, right now I don't know who's gonna win because it's a back-to-back game, and right now the score is real close, only up by one. The course is only up by one.
I know. Like, I have a feeling that by the end of this game, it's gonna be like 2 or 1 point off.
Yeah. Right now the score is tied 18-18.
With 7 seconds left on the clock, the score is tied 18-18.
Christopher Bowden actually took over in his last 4 minutes of the game. He scored about, 6 points in about 30 seconds?
Yeah, ooh, that's beautiful. I wish I could do that.
Yeah, the courts has been doing good. But I think in the second half, they actually need to tighten up on a little bit of defense and start making a couple more jump shots.
Also, the court, you know, so far they had many, you know, free throws throughout the game. I think that's probably why they're tight at this moment.
Yeah, in a minute, somebody's going to be in foul trouble. Number six for the Heat, Linnell Williams is shooting a free throw. He hits his first one already. He shoots the second, and he hits. The ball is inbounds. 5 seconds to go. He shoots. Number one shoots and misses. Number 14 for the court. Try to get the rebound. Kicks it back out. And it's a shot put up, but it was no good. So the score being 18-19, the Heat is taking the lead right now at the end of the first half.
Man, this is a tough game. I really don't know who's going to win.
I actually think the Heat is going to pull this game out if Christopher Bowden keep playing the ways he's playing.
Mm-hmm. Also, Clinton Miller from the court, he's really well throughout this game.
Yeah, it's a lot of things going on in between both teams. You know, I actually think that if the court... we're going to toss it to our sideline reporter, Jeanette, for an interview.
Hi, I'm Janae Tay here with Coach Mason. He is right now coaching the Heat. So, Coach, what are your games on the game so far?
Well, the kids playing hard so far. We got some small adjustments we need to make at halftime, and we'll be all right come the end of the game.
So, what are your plans to do to help get your boys back in the league?
Well, just play a little bit more solid defense. Play a little bit more help defense and get to where we're supposed to be at on the floor.
So how does these training games, those summer and spring, how does he help your boys for the regular season?
Give them something to do, keep them off the streets, and have them doing something positive instead of just hanging out.
I thank you, Coach, so much. And now we're going to toss it back to the announcers.
We are back here at the Golden Dome.
With the Heat and the court taking on each other, now the score is 18-19. And we're going into the second half. Now they're just warming up, getting a few shots in, you know, warming up for the game.
So, Genesis, how do you feel about basketball in general? Like, what's your view about basketball?
Well, how I feel about basketball is, you know, I'm a player myself, so I'm all right. I don't play for a team, actually. But it's pretty cool for the most part. I enjoy playing. How about you?
You know, I actually play basketball. I play organized basketball until like high school, and then I stopped playing. But now I just play basketball for fun.
Yeah, I do that also. You know, I play during school. I play Tuesdays and Thursdays when I could, you know. But I enjoy playing basketball for fun. You know, I would take it on as a sport if I had the time.
I mean, first you got to start hitting some shots.
I'll make shots. Thank you, Marcus.
There you go. There
yes,
you go.
I do.
I saw you play like once, and you was horrible.
You called me on a bad day. It was cold outside.
So, the second half is underway.
Yeah, second half is done. We are done. Now the score, we're leading into the second half with a score 18-19. With the Heat versus the court, let's see who takes home this win.
remember, you guys, it's 20 minutes for a half. So anything can happen during a half. I mean, the course can take off, get a lead. The Heat can come back, tie the ball up, get a lead, anything. I believe the Heat are going to take the ball out when the second half is underway.
I see a lot of teamwork with these two teams. They communicate very well.
The Courts actually have more people on the bench than the Heat. The Heat only has two players on the bench, and the Court has actually four. So if they want to sub a whole five in, they could.
Yeah.
No, actually, the Courts are going to take the ball out.
We have Clinton Miller, number one, from the Court, taking on the ball.
They set the play up, number zero. Williford sets the play up. Good pick. Crosses over. Drives to the hole, kicks it out. Oh, turnover by the Court. The Heat will be inbounding the ball, bringing it down court. Brings the ball down to the top of the key. Number six, Linnell Williams.
The Heat has a good way of, you know, communicating with the ball and passing. So I think this is why they caught up so quickly.
Williams for a three-point shot, and it goes in.
Great shot, by the way.
I actually think Ballin's trying to take over because, as you can see, Genesis, the first play, he shot the ball from the three-point line, and he's a big man. He should be taking the ball in.
Yeah, use your body to the advantage.
The Heat commits a foul on the Court. It was a reach-in foul. Brings the ball up, number zero, Williford. He's a true point guard out here today. Drives. Hand check on number six for the Heat, Hoyd. The referee out there explaining the call. A little confusion out there between the coach and the referee. Number one for the Courts, drives the ball, and he misses. Rebound by number six, Williams. Williams drives the ball, sets it up, passes to Hoyt. Hoyt pulls up, passes to Bowen. Bowen kicks it back out, shoots a three-pointer, and it's off. Rebound by the Courts. Roger Williams got the rebound, passes the ball. Number 21 is getting fouled down there. James King is getting fouled in a hole.
The PSAs, dramas, and documentaries that you've seen between breaks on Hoopside are produced by Free Spirit Media students at North Lundell College Preparatory High School, the Gary Coleman Youth Center, and Powerhouse High. We hope that you enjoy the stories and messages that our young people are sharing.
Quick turnover there by the Heat, and another turnover by the Court. Two turnovers within about 10 seconds.
Speaking of the PSAs, I did one in the past myself about no carbon copies. You know, it's no problem with just being different.
Yeah, it's about all about individuality, being yourself, not fitting in. It was a blocking foul on the Courts, number one, Crenshawn Miller, the blocking foul.
He fell pretty hard.
Yeah, I think Coach got mad at him because he's subbing him out. In comes the game, number seven for the Courts, Jabari Harris. Williams with the ball, driving pass. I actually think it was a 3 second lane violation call.
We are at 16-36 with a score 18-22.
Actually, number seven, Jabari Harris drives the ball. Gets fouled. The referee said it was on ground, so they would not be shooting free throws. Roger Williams will inbound the ball for the Courts. Justice, what do you think the Courts need to improve to take the lead back?
On passing, I see that the Heat has more passing than the Court does, so I think they just need to, you know, pass just a little more instead of being like a ball hog, I'm assuming.
Yeah, I actually agree with you on that. Actually, Hort was just called for a carry, and now the court would take the ball out.
Please check out the Free Spirit Media website at www.freespiritmedia.org to learn what Free Spirit is all about, or check us out on YouTube. Search Free Spirit Media to view our YouTube channel.
Jabari Harris with the ball, brings it back out for the court, sets it up, looks at his teammate. He looked at Willie for it because he's the only true point guard out here. Harris with the drive, lays the ball up. Ooh, number 21. James King tried to tip dunk it, but he missed.
Harris looked kind of mad since he missed the shot. I guess he worked hard on that play.
Actually, the call was basket interference by James King. He should have let the ball come off first, then dunk.
My mistake.
Sub Terrell Allen is in for the courts. Pass the ball up. Oh, doubles. Doubles is called on Mr. Linnell Williams for the Heat. Genesis, I noticed that it has been a lot of turnovers in the second half so far.
Yes, I saw that too. And once when I was playing basketball, not knowing what I was doing at the beginning, I did do doubles. So, yeah, I feel this pain right now.
Yeah, I agree with you. That was a quick foul, number one for the courts. Crenshawn Miller drives the ball and got fouled by a Heat player. He hits his first free throw. He will be shooting another one.
How do you feel about Clintron Miller?
You know, I actually think his game is actually decent because he has been driving the ball. He has been hitting a couple of jump shots. And actually, when the Heat played defense on him, he wasn't scared. So I think he can handle well under pressure. There was a double call by Imari Hurd. And he turns the ball up. It's another turnover, Genesis.
Another one already? It's crazy.
Number one, Miller with the ball, dribbles, top of the key, drives, pulls up for a jump shot, and he hits the three-pointer.
That was beautiful. Wow.
Great play, great play. Miller came off the screen and pulls up for the three-pointer and hit it.
Now the score is tied 22-22 with 13:18 left on the clock. This is really a tight game. Let's see it to the end.
Yeah, the Courts were just losing by four, now it's tied. Oh, turnover,
oh,
another
wow.
Turnover. Court with the ball, passes to Williams. Williams drives. Oh, he loses the ball, another turnover. Number 23, LaShawn Lewis with the steal. Back to Miller. Miller playing point guard now. Oh, he turns the ball up, another turnover. Oh my God.
This is like, wow.
Blocking foul.
That was like four or five turnovers within like the last minute. It's amazing.
Yeah, so I actually think they need to slow down, Genesis. If they slow down and make the great pass, then it would be less turnovers.
Yeah, I believe so.
The coach wasn't feeling that group because he subs three players out for the courts and runs the three starting five back in. Hort with a three-pointer, and misses. Hort pulls up for another three-pointer, and he misses that again. Fight for the rebound. Bowen get the rebound. Pass the ball. Turnover. Miller with the steal.
Don't forget to stay tuned for the Free Spirit Media News at the end of this broadcast. It comes on at 9:50 every Saturday. Learn about what's going on in Chicago and find out the latest on the most important issues with teens. I agree with that. I might watch it.
Everybody's here at the Golden Dome to see the Court versus the Heat today.
Yeah.
There's a packed gym out here.
A lot of supporters.
Very close game.
This game has been tied for like, not anymore. 24-22 with 11:23 left on the clock.
Yeah, LaShawn Lewis hit a great layup. Oh, I think he traveled that. Bowen scores off that play. I thought he actually traveled. As I told you, Jens, I think he's going to take over his second half because he's been shooting the ball, been driving.
Yeah, I see what you mean. He's a very good player.
Boy, with the pass to number one, he lays the ball up against foul. He would be going to the line to shoot two free throws.
That was a nice tip hand, by the way.
You know, this game has been crazy because it's a lot of fouls, a lot of turnovers, fast-paced game.
I also agree with that.
He hits the first free throw. He would be shooting another one.
The Heat is now in the lead with 25 against the court with 24 with 10:19 left on the clock.
He actually hits his second free throw, so now it's 26-24. Miller gets out the press, passes to number 14 for the court, Terrell Allen. Back to Miller. Miller drives, layup, he misses.
Finally, Miller drives through the hoop, you know, to the hoop.
He gets his rebound back and goes back up, but it's a foul.
The time is ticking, and I guess my prediction was right. You know, they may lose or win 2 points or less. You know, either way, it was a good game.
Miller misses an important free throw. He's shooting another one. At this point in time, it's a lot of time left on the clock, and the game can go any way, but right now, the court needs all the points they can get. Miller hits the second free throw. Bowen passes the ball to Horry to Williams. Williams with the three-point shot. He misses. Rebound by number 12, DeAndre Winters. He gets fouled on the play. He's going to the free throw line and shoot two free throws. And once again, Genesis, another foul. And we're going to pass it to our sideline reporter, Jeanette, for an interview.
Or watch TV.
Yeah. Hi, I'm here with Sire. He plays basketball for the court. So, Sire, knowing that you play basketball, what do you get out of watching other players play?
I get a lot of I just watch the guards' moves and who we're going to play next year and who's better and who's not.
Okay, so tell me, what have you been doing in the game so far?
I'm seeing Marshall play Foreman and see who Marshall guard's going to have next year and Foreman guard's going to have next year.
Okay, so tell me, you know, during these, you know, spring and summer training games, how does these games help you for the regular season?
Oh, it helps a lot. Like, we get better from running up and down the court, getting in shape, get college coaches looking at us and see who we're going to play next year and win the title.
Okay, thank you so much. Now you're going to toss it back to our announcers.
Thank you, Jeanette, for the great interview. Since the interview was playing, a lot of things has been going on. You know, Allen turns the ball over for the court. He brings the ball back down. They get fouled. Now at the line, it's number one for the Heat. And he shoots a free throw. And he hits it. He shoots the second free throw and he hits it also. That was a great interview by Jeanette, don't you think, Genesis?
Yeah, it's very good.
Sire Kara is actually he's a beast out there on the court. He scores he averaged about 25 points a game, about 10 rebounds.
That is amazing. Once again, I wish I could do that.
I wonder why Sire Kara is not playing today.
I have no idea, but so far the game is good, and I believe they're keeping up good points with him not in the game or with him in the game, you know, it's all good.
Imagine the intensity of the game if Carroll was out there playing, like the score would be in like the 50s right about now. He'll have about half of the points. Okay, so the Heat is actually in a bonus right now. So every foul, the court will be going to the line to shoot free throws.
The score is 29, the Heat with 29, and the court with 25 with 6:15 left on the clock.
Sean Lewis shoots his first free throw, and he misses. It's 1-1 free throws because of the bonus.
For the first time in the game, the score is The score is up by 4 points. By the way, if you can't seem to get enough of Hoopside, friend us on Facebook, get to know the crew, and let in what goes in every Hoopside production.
As Genesis says, the largest lead of the game, only by 4 points, so you can tell it's been a close game.
Yeah, I see they're put the game faces on by now.
Yeah, it's going to be crazy. This last 5 minutes of the second half is going to be crazy because both teams know this game is on the line, and they're going to do their best to actually win the game.
I feel that they are very intense right now.
A drive by the Heat. Williams lays the ball up, got an and one. Number 23 for the Courts. LaShawn Lewis fouled him on that play.
Score is 27-31 with 5:03 left in the game.
Timeout called by the Courts, and we're going to pass it to a quick PSA.
Am I being followed? Will I be harassed? Oh, not him again. Let me go.
Hey, why you gotta act all like that for? I was just trying to get your name. Keep walking.
Hey, man. Come on, man. Girls these days don't even know how to act. Why you trying to get to know them? You want to act all crazy.
Imagine not being able just to walk down the street.
I'm Special K from 103.5 KISS FM.
And I'm Connie, your girlfriend from 6 to 10 at 107.5 WGCI.
And you are watching Hoops High. Like hoops.
These are hoops.
You are watching Hoops High. We are at the Golden Dome where we have the Court versus playing the Heat. The score is now 27-31. The Heat is up 31 and the Court has 27 with 5:03 left in this half.
He are at the free throw line, shooting another free throw. Before that break, it was a foul committed by LaShawn Lewis. And Williams for the Heat got an and-one off that play.
The Heat has really improved throughout this game, I believe, because, like I said earlier, the score was either a point or 2 points up. Now they're up by...
Five points. And another turnover. And once again, it was a kick ball, but the ref didn't call it. On number 21 for the Courts. Oh my God, it was a lot going on that play. He tried to lay the ball up, but he got some block, and he came down with the block. So there was a travel call on that play. Yeah, I don't know how the ref missed that kick ball call. Bowden with the ball, brings it down. Shakes and bakes. Pass the ball out to number one for Green. At the top of the key, jab steps, drives. Pass the ball. Oh, turnover. Another turnover this half.
Good defense by number one, Clinton Miller.
Yeah, it was great defense. I think right now he's the only one for the Courts trying to do something for his team.
Yeah, I believe so. We know we are not always perfect, but we are working hard and always learning. We thank you for your support and encouragement.
Another foul has been committed by the Heat. And number 23 for the shot will be going for the free throw.
Let's see if the score changes besides being 5 points up. Let's see if it makes four.
He misses the first free throw. We really need that free throw for the Court.
Yeah. Your time left is 3:20 in this half.
He goes for a second free throw, and he misses the free throw. Oh, my God.
Wow. With 3 minutes left, 5 points up in this half, the Heat really is showing off in this game. Let's see if the Court will bring it up within the 3 minutes.
Those is crunch time free throws. He needed both of them. 5 second call. Good defense by Miller.
Yes, very good defense by Miller. I'm watching him. I'm like, man, this guy is good.
Yeah, Miller's doing awesome right now. He calls for the ball. He knows his team is down by five. He's trying to get the win today. Miller pulls up for a three, and he misses. The Heat with good hustle by Williams for the Heat. And it's another timeout call by the Heat. And we're going to pass it to a quick PSA.
I heard you was talking to some boys.
I'm not about to put up with you talking to other people.
Your friends got you out here looking promiscuous. I'm starting to even wonder if I want to be with you anymore. If I see you talking to any other boys, we gonna have some problems.
Should I find new friends? Is he looking out for me? Does he love me? I don't get it. Why is he so controlling?
What's up? This is Larry Hughes. You're watching Hoops High.
The Heat will inbound the ball. Bowen with the inbound pass to number six. Williams passed to Bowen. Bowen passes to number two. Oh, another turnover.
I believe that pass was too hard for him.
The Heat is now pressing. They're trying to press Miller to get the ball out of his hand. Another turn. No, Bowen tried to steal the ball, but it knocks it out of bounds. 2 minutes to go in the second half. The question is all the points they can get. The Heat is pressing, passes the ball, breaks the press. Number three with the ball. Oh, my God. It takes the ball away from him so easy. Bowen passes the ball to Hoyt. Hoyt turns the ball over. Another turnover. Pass the ball to zero for the courts. 10-drop layup misses. Williams with the rebound. Oh, crossover. He crossed Miller over.
Want to see more Hoops High? Now you can see full games on our brand new website. Go to www.hoopshigh.org to see games from the past or stream live from home or your mobile device.
The courts are planning on to make two substitutions, trying to bring Terrell Allen in and Jabari Harrison. I guess the coach is not impressed by his team right now. Williams with the rebound. With the free throw shot, and he hits his first free throw shot.
The Heat is up by 6, 33-27, with a minute and 41 left in the game. Man, this is an incredible game.
Yeah, I actually think, Genesis, that the Heat is going to win this game right here today.
Yeah, I really believe it. When the second half began, they put on their game faces and came out strong.
Number three, passes the ball to number one for number 14 for the court. Back to Miller. Miller passes the ball. Number three gets chopped in the corner by the Heat. Passes the ball to number 23. Deshaun Lewis with the layup misses. Oh, they down there fighting. Turnover by the Heat. Number one with the turnover. Of course, inbound the ball with 1:20 left to go in the second half. Jabari Harris will inbound the ball for the courts. Pulls up for a three, misses. Number 23, LaShawn with the rebound. Goes back up, gets fouled. He'll be going to the line to shoot two free throws. These are big free throws right here, Genesis.
Yes, I really believe so, because this will be the only way they'll catch up 2 points in this game.
They are losing by six, so with two free throws, it'll cut it down to 4 points, going with that about a minute and 15 seconds to go.
Yeah, it won't be a huge loss. At least it's, you know, a minor loss. Wasn't too many points off from a win, you know?
With the thing, oh, he missed the first free throw.
Man. Yeah, I really have a feeling the Heat is going to win this game.
I wonder how Lewis feels about missing that free throw. He actually missed, what, two more free throws within his last 2 minutes of the game.
Yeah, he just needs to focus.
He misses yet another free throw.
I believe number 23 from the court, he's really, you know, under pressure trying to win a game. So I believe that's why he missed the free throws throughout this game.
You can see the frustration in Tyrese Williford's eyes. It was a foul committed on the play. The Sean Lewis comes at the game, I think the coach knows that this game is over with.
Yeah. Number 23 from the court, walking off the court, looks very disappointed.
Yeah, but the great thing about this tournament is that it's over 100 games, so I'm pretty sure both teams will play in many more games, and they will learn to play with each other and get wins and get losses.
Yeah, I agree. Now this game is up by 6-7 points.
It's up by 7, Genesis.
My mistake, sorry.
It's okay. We all make mistakes. Miller with the rebound for the courts. Drives the ball up. He looks at the time. 1:05 to go. He passes to Harris. Harris drives, kicks it out to Williford. Williford backs to Miller. Miller pulls up for a 3-point. Misses. A push in the back by a number 2 for the Heat. Thornton with the foul.
53 seconds to go. 7 points up. Heat 34. Court 27. Man, I tell you, the Heat really got the flame now in this court.
Willie first about to shoot another free throw, and he misses the free throw. You know, the Heat actually turned this game up in the second half. They started playing tremendous defense, hitting big shots, and now there's luck that's going to take on a W today.
Yeah. Wow, a free shot by the court. Put 1 point on the board.
Williford hit this free throw. They're pressing. Oh, good steal. Pass the ball to Miller. Miller drives, layup, and it's in.
Hey.
Only down by 4 points now. 39 seconds to go.
Man, you really don't know who you want to go for in this game, because it's like as the time going down, everybody want to just, you know, win. So I guess everybody want to win.
But with the turnovers now, Genesis, I actually think if the Heat make a couple turnovers, this game is right back in it. And, oh, what they call? They call a foul on number 7, Jabari Harris. Why would he foul? With a close game like this, only down by 4 with 36 seconds to go, Harris should not have fouled. If he haven't fouled, it probably would. Probably be another turnover by the Heat, because both teams has been turning the ball over all game.
And if this Heat make this free throw, they gonna be up by 5. You just don't know where this game gonna go. There we go. 35-30 with 36 left on the clock.
Gets the first free throw, going for a second free throw. And he haven't missed any free throws, none in this game, so. He actually misses this free throw for a change. Miller drives the ball up court, driving all the way. He gets fouled.
With 31 seconds left on the clock.
He would be going to the line and shoot a free throw. And these are big free throws right here. These are make it or make it.
I really hope he make it. Just shake off the nervousness and win for your team.
He has been there. Their go-to guy today. I mean, he hits the first free throw.
Good job.
One more free throw. Miller will be attempting. Miller holds the ball, waits. Shoots it, and he hits.
Good job by Miller with 3 points down, 30 seconds to go. Let's see what happens.
Wins with the ball for the Heat, brings the ball up. Trying to hold the ball, stall time, turnover.
Wow.
Miller drives the ball, layup. Oh, he missed the layup. We needed that layup. The courts needed that layup.
Man.
He knows it.
3 points down, 17.8 seconds to go. Man, this is an intense game.
He gives his teammate Harris a handshake because he stole the ball from him. But Miller needed to hit that layup. These are big free throws for Miller right now. He hits the first free throw.
This is crazy, man. This is crazy. 17 seconds. 2 points down.
One more free throw. Come on, Miller. This whole team is depending on him. Miller hits the free throw. Only down by one now.
Down by one. 17 seconds to go. Man. Ooh.
Harris playing great defense. Ball goes out of bounds, but the Heat will be inbounding the ball. I won't be surprised, Genesis, if they turn the ball back over.
Woo-hoo! Man, I won't be surprised either. Wow.
Bowden brings the ball up. Oh, they fouled Bowden. Good foul.
11.8 seconds to go. The Heat up by one, 35-31.
Genesis, imagine if Bowden missed one of these free throws. It actually can go in overtime if the Courts come here and hit a shot.
Man, I can't even predict this game no more. It's crazy.
Yeah, this last 3 minutes of this game has been crazy.
Yeah.
They was up by what? The Heat was up by seven, and then now it's a one-point game. Oh, he missed the free throw.
Oh, wow.
These are big free throws, and he missed the first one.
The very first one. So, Marcus, how you feel with this happening in, like, 5 minutes that such 7 points came down to 1 point? Like, for real?
It's crazy, Genesis. But Bowen hit the second free throw, and now it's a two-point game. Let's see what Miller's going to do. Miller passes to Williford, pass to Allen. Allen shoots. Oh, he gets the block by number 12. Oh, man, his team is mad at him.
2 points up. Heat 36, Court 34 with 3.2 seconds left on this clock. Man, their faces is like, can't even really describe right now. They both won it. Let's see who gets it with 3 seconds left on the clock.
DeAndre Winters is at the free throw line about to shoot two free throws. These are big free throws also, because if you miss both of them, it's still enough time for the Courts to come down and hit a shot.
Man,
he hits the first free throw. Now they're up by three. If he hits the second free throw, game is over with. Winter shoots the second free throw, and he hits it. The game is over with. He has taken home the W, got the win for this game. Miller shoots a half court shot, wow. But this game is over with.
What an amazing win for the Heat, 38-34. Like, man, 4 points up. This is beautiful. This was a good game. How you feel about this game, Marcus?
Man, I actually felt that this was a great game to watch. I'm glad I'm here. I'm glad I'm with you announcing this game. And man, this was very entertaining. Only a 4-point win. So, man, this is great.
I appreciate your comment about being here with me. Thank you very much.
Of course.
Man, but this was a really good game. I actually enjoyed it.
Yeah, it was up and down all game, and then it came to the point where the Heat took over the game and actually started winning the game, and then the Courts tried to come back, and they actually got it down by one, and then now the game was just over with after the two made free throws by DeAndre Winters.
Yeah, Deontay Winters and Quintron Miller, they was the two men to look out for throughout this game.
So we're going to pass it to our announcer, Jeanette, for an interview.
Hi, I'm here with Lanell Williams from the Court. He is the MVP. So tell me, how does it feel to be MVP?
It feels great. I play good.
So,
So
is there anything you feel that you or your team could do to improve for the next game?
To play more defense, to play harder.
Well, thank you so much and congratulations. You can catch Hoops High every Saturday at 8 o'clock on CanTV Channel 19. Thank you for watching Hoops High and good night.
You can watch Hoops High on CanTV Channel 19 every Saturday at 8 p.m. Please visit www.hoopshigh.org to learn more. Hoops High and Free Spirit Media would like to thank our sponsors. We are grateful for their support in making our mission of youth media education and opportunity possible.
Hoops High is family, communication.
Enjoy it. Hoops High is
astounding, creativity,
commitment.
Hoops High is exciting, meaningful.
Hoops High is
technology.
Spirit.
A community.
High is home. Love.
Dedication.
Inspired.
Probably never was exposed to it, they probably would have never have done it, but it's something that you see that interests people a lot.
I never worked with a camera, you know, my first time learning about a camera, you know, zooming in, zooming out. It was a real good experience for me, you know. I think it changed a lot in me too. It changed my how I think, and it changed like something I like to do in life.
When I get older, I want to be some type of actor. So being in this classroom really helped me out, really exercised my ability to act.
We shooting it and we shoot it off like what we done been through, and like people get to see it and they watching it and they liking it.
Like young kids in the community can do stuff that's like worth some type of value.
Meet Jaden, a 16-year-old from Chicago. He likes reading, playing basketball, and daydreaming. As one of 75 million youth in America, he is the future of our country. But today, Jaden's future is uncertain. A new economy is evolving as Jaden tries to find his way in a school system where more than 42% of students drop out and even more fall behind. For Jaden and others like him, the future looks grim. But there is hope. Youth media programs connect with kids like Jaden, moving them from discouragement toward opportunity through the power of communication. Jaden learns about journalism, technology, and culture. He spends his time engaged at school, in youth centers, and at libraries. He discovers how to observe the world around him and share his own stories. He becomes one of more than 10,000 teens involved in the Chicago Youth Voices Network, a collection of innovative programs that come together with a bold vision to reach more people like Jaden, to transform education, and to shape the health of our city. Together, the network gives vision to the journalists, artists, engineers, and leaders of our future. One story, poem, film, blog post, one youth at a time.
Ingram.
And Uncle Vontae Sneed.
Aaron here at Westhouse for the first Daniel Hoops High Free Throw Classic.
Check us out every Saturday at 8 p.m. on Channel 19 CAN TV.
I remember watching anime when I was younger, and for me it was just all about the action. Like, I just liked the way they fought and different things like that. But now that I'm older, I start to see things and notice things. And I'm wondering, is it more than just cartoons? So my question is, like, what is anime?
Anime is an art form used for telling stories in an audiovisual medium. But it's a lot more than that.
It's like, the only thing I know about Japanese culture is like the hang tang on your eye. You know, like, everybody joke about it, about Asian culture. So I never really, like, dug into it.
It's very hard to sort of make a joke about anime if you don't know what you're talking about. You come off sounding really ignorant.
Mm-hmm.
She'll be like, oh, you like cartoons. And it's just like, aww.
But then when I started watching anime, I don't know. I guess I have a lot more respect for them and their craft.
Some of the inspiration came undoubtedly from American comic books, hence the wide-eyed characters.
It's Betty Boop, so it's like the beginning of animation as a medium for storytelling. It started early on, like with the very beginnings of film, like Astro Boy was black and white. I was really influenced by cartoons and Japanese artists and the heavy lines and the printmaking and the very stylistic images they would make and how they influenced European artists.
Anime was using a lot of Western techniques, but after years went by, anime started to progress and it started to branch off and use its own cultural identity. And then Western animation started using techniques that Japanese anime came up with, or Japanese creators came up with for anime, and they used it in Western animation.
Like, you start seeing the idiosyncrasies in their behavior, as far as just like how they greet each other when they come to houses, like daily life stuff, geographical stuff.
I've seen a lot of interesting looking foods, religious practices.
It depends on the type of anime that you're looking at.
Any one of the Hayao Miyazaki films is a fantastic way to learn about Japanese culture, because
if you didn't sort of go the extra length into actually trying to look into the culture, you probably wouldn't even get a lot of the jokes.
Maybe a more natural part of the storyline in the anime stories that I've seen.
One time in an animation class, we actually saw a side-by-side comparison of the kids having to fight in the Boondocks, and it's actually a frame-for-frame redoing of a fight scene in Naruto. And I just found that really interesting how they take existing footage from anime and make it, have it in a completely new context. And I just found that really interesting to watch.
Anime can be looked at as a direct representation of Japanese culture because it has so many small pieces of Japanese culture, tradition, history, and style inside it.
The way I've seen just it's presented naturally, like, okay, this is part of our world.
Japan, at least what I could tell, going back into antiquity, their history isn't broken.
In the 1920s, Japan was working hard to become an industrialized nation, but discrimination towards the Japanese was a big problem, and it led to the deterioration of the companionship between the West and the East.
Japan was an isolated island until Commodore Perry opened it to America in 1858. But even after, Japan remained mostly closed to many foreign influences until the leading up to World War II. In 1924, the U.S. Congress passed the Exclusive Act that prohibited further immigration from Japan. And after World War II, in the 1930s, the U.S. military almost had total control over Japan's government. After Japan's surrender in 1945, the United States instituted sweeping changes in Japan through every aspect of life, such as new constitution, democratics, education, labor reforms, etc. Japan was westernized and they needed a way to form cultural identity, and the Japanese found a way to do that through art.
I feel like a lot of anime and manga and pretty much any Japanese art from came after World War II. So it was trying to like reclaim and reshape their identity after what happened to them, trying to fight for the Japanese culture in a time when, during the American occupation.
Japan was westernizing because of the occupation and because of the upset of the war.
Anime was like a way of escape. I will say it was a chance to keep in remembrance and reclaim their cultural identity. To quote historian Susan Naper, film and the visual mass media in general can indeed help to write history and create national identity.
Culturally, and saying that, they tend to embrace a lot of their older habits, a lot of their older traditions.
In the West, it's always about industry, the Industrial Revolution, and like conquering nature. But in Japan, it's more of like, it's something you literally have to live with. You have to have some degree of respect for what sustains your own life.
In the West, for the most part, they're biased, but with Japanese and Japanese tradition and culture, they see everything as equal. You don't look at just one thing, you need both. You can't just weigh one side heavier than the other. They all both have to be equal and they have to balance out. And that's when Shinto religion comes in.
Shinto religion is kind of like the native religion for Japan.
I'm not sure how many people are still of the Shinto faith there. It's so ingrained in the culture that it still pops up a lot.
When you think of like Native Americans, they worship sort of nature gods. So you have like the fox spirit and the trees all have spirit. And like if you've ever seen any of Miyazaki's work, there's a lot of Shinto woven into the landscape of his films.
The closest one I can think of at the moment is Princess Mononoke, where it's all about striking a balance between the environment versus personal gain. San, the princess, she just has completely turned herself away from humanity and lives with the animals and wants to be a spirit of nature. And then you have her rival is Lady Eboshi, who symbolizes like industry and factories. And at first glance, it's like it would be so easy to like just see her like one-dimensional villain because she's like industry and that's bad. But then she realized like no one is like a clear-cut hero or villain.
Customs from feudal Japan are still used now, today in Japan. And you can see that in anime, whether it's through food or the way they greet each other or the way they talk to each other or even the way that they show affection.
They think they're cool or just because off habit, you know, like ninjas and samurais. That's all older Japanese history. But I mean, when you start like looking at, you know, the way they name their characters, it'll be off of like older Japanese generals or, you know, older clans and things like that. So they're always digging back into like their history and then pulling that and referencing it.
That's why if you look at something like Naruto, it follows in certain respects Japanese history, where it looks like it could be in a time almost like this.
Right.
Some of them still kind of dress like it's a feudal era Japan. Things that happened 1,000 years ago still have relevance, still have a place now.
When I watched anime, I understood most things, but there were like also a lot of things they referred to that I've never heard of. And that's when I officially made the connection that anime, when I went further, was more than just a form of entertainment.
Anime means that, especially now, that it's more than just a specific storyline. That animation can tell hugely complex and adult stories in any subgenre that you can think of.
Anime is more than entertainment. I would say it's like a window into another culture. And when you watch anime, you start to see the subtleties and Japanese identity in anime, and it starts to reflect real life.
Everything that I know, but it sounds like I read a book. I haven't read books on Japanese culture really. Yeah. No, I've read articles, I've read pieces. And the reason I read those pieces because there's a cartoon or a movie that made me go, I wonder what this is about.
You definitely can learn a lot of stuff from anime, just as far as taking it into the context that it is. It's a very Japanese-centric art. And as long as you understand that, you know, It may not necessarily be indicative of like life in general, like this is exactly how it works or all this stuff happens.
You know what I'm saying?
Right.
Are you learning world history a little bit about Japanese culture? And that's when the lights start going off and I start going, oh, I saw this and this, I saw this and this, I saw this and this, da 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 da. But all of this I'm talking about are all anime, a manga. So the manga anime would have grouped to like my curiosity about Japanese culture. And it explained a lot.
But when you start looking at the basis of things of, you know, either what happened in their history or how they psychologically deal with these things and how that manifests in the content, then you start seeing connections between things. So I mean, if you pay attention, you'll be able to pick up a lot of stuff as far as like their cultural cues and whatever.
Anime refers to a lot of Japanese history, and you can see that in anime, whether it's referred to characters' names, their background, where they're from, or their homeland.
How I got into it was funny because there are two stories to it. It's like, how did I get into watching this style of cartoon versus how did I get into searching for this cartoon? A lot of this I learned from Japanese anime.
Right.
Like, a lot of this came from me watching it all, then going, okay, these things are constant. Then messing around and reading something in school, then going, oh, I already got told about this. Because I was watching an episode of Dragon Ball Z.
Right.
Or me going from calling ramen noodles, calling it ramen. Because ramen is what it's called in Japan.
It's noodles. Right.
Yeah, it's noodles. You know what I'm saying? There's stuff like that that I didn't realize, or even a technique to like a good bowl of ramen. I learned that from Naruto.
So you know how to cook it?
I like you give me, like if I get the ingredients, yeah, I'll do the best version I could do, not being from Japan
right.
or having like Japanese friends around me to correct me.
Anime projects this idea that while you're watching it, it's exclusively fitted for a certain culture. It's like looking out the window into another culture.
Man, this test hard. Let me see your test. Hey.
What?
You got a dollar? Thank you. Hey, can I get some of your chips?
Man, you beg too much, yeah.
Dang, you could have saved me some more. But hey, let me see the ball.
Hey, man, on the real though, you gotta stop begging so much.
Come on, man.
I mean, you gotta be independent and not codependent.
You know what? You right.
When I think of breast cancer, I think of survival, extended life.
Hope, total fear.
I don't think, Kenya, there's really a reason. We looked at family history. We looked at location where I was living. We looked at conditions, looked at diet. I don't think there was any real reason why I was diagnosed other than I was a woman with breasts.
Without good health, you have absolutely nothing. I don't care how rich you are, how wonderful your life is. If you don't have good health, you don't function well anymore.
Most people take their health for granted. So when you're feeling good and feeling healthy, you may not associate that with happiness. But if you started getting sick or were told you had breast cancer, then it would affect the quality of your life. Or people would certainly say that their happiness is affected when they're not healthy. And so health is important for people's overall sense of well-being.
At the time, I was operating a safe and sober house for women that was coming in from a 28-day program. And I was up in the mirror and I was showing them how to do a self breast exam when I discovered for myself a lump in my breast. It was kind of a panicky situation. But I finished the presentation and then I went downstairs and I got on the phone and I began to talk to my doctor and he said, come in right away.
80% of all breast cancers start in the milk ducts of the breast. They're the little tubes that take the milk to the baby. They start in there and eventually figure out a way to break out into the surrounding tissue and then potentially can travel. So you can have a very, very healthy person who eats great and exercises all the time and still gets a breast cancer. But in terms of lowering your risk of developing one, exercise, maintaining a healthy weight, limiting alcohol intake, those things are all lifestyle choices and things you can modify.
In general, if you look at African American women compared to white women in the nation and in Chicago, we tend to not be as healthy overall. Now, that may not be the case for a specific black woman and a specific white woman, but if you look at the numbers and the populations in general, African Americans tend to be less healthy.
Chicago is one of the worst performing cities in terms of the disparities according to breast cancer. So my colleagues and I have published a paper, and in that paper we compared the disparities, the difference between black and white breast cancer mortality rates in the 25 biggest cities in the United States. And among those 25 biggest cities, Chicago was the fourth worst. And black women are almost twice as likely to die from breast cancer as white women.
There are lots and lots of different things that go into that. But one of them certainly is access to health care. And certain groups, especially African Americans, have a higher rate of uninsurance. And they also access, we have data to show that they access often less high quality care. Both of those affect survival.
Black women don't get enough mammography. So they need to get more mammograms, and they need to get them at regular rates. That's one cause. The second is that the quality of mammography is frequently inferior for black women. And so we need to make sure that the quality of those mammograms is higher. So when a cancer is present, the mammogram will detect it as early and as soon as possible when it's small, and then we can treat it effectively.
The University of Illinois did a recent study where they looked at women who were diagnosed with breast cancer, and then they looked at if they had had a mammogram a year before or 2 years before, and they looked at those mammograms, and they often found signs of early breast cancer in the prior mammograms that had been missed. And when they looked at the sort of women who had the highest miss rate, it was poor women, women who were publicly insured, women with less education.
Because I take care of a population of women who are un or underinsured, what you see is a lot of them come in at much later stages where the tumors are, the cancers are bigger, they've already spread beyond to the lymph nodes or to somewhere other part of their body.
If you don't have a good health plan and you don't have access to a car that will get you to your doctor quickly, it is difficult. So many African American women may not go, or they're so busy with their children that they're putting them first and not their health first. And so quite often I think our death rate is higher because they don't diagnose it to us in the later stage.
We still have dual systems of healthcare in this country that's delivered by things around class and race and economics and things like that. And so if you're poor and live in a poor community and don't have good insurance, then which black women are more likely to be, then your ability to, again, get good quality care is less.
Here's the two main impediments to making things better: poverty and racism. And I think there's a lot of both of those in Chicago, and they're both, of course, attacking black women more than any other group of women.
In the last few years, the state of Illinois has had some very significant budget problems. And so when a state has those sort of budget problems, they have to decide on their priorities. We would suggest that they've made some bad choices in how they've allocated resources. And so Governor Quinn last year proposed to cut $3.3 million from the breast and cervical cancer program.
I don't know if you're aware of this, but there's only one industrialized country in the world that does not have a national healthcare system, and that country is the United States. And so instead you have a lot of poor people not being able to afford healthcare. They don't have insurance, they can't get healthcare, and then, for example, they can't afford to pay for a mammogram.
So for me, I'm a physician, I work at a hospital, so I had really good access to high quality care. And that's not the case for all women in Chicago, in the nation, and particularly for women who look like me. So black women in the city tend to have a harder time navigating the healthcare system and getting good quality care when you compare them to white women.
Knowledge is power. Once you know and understand about this body and how it works and the issues that we as women go through, then we're equipped with information, and that information gives us an opportunity to take control of our own health.
My biggest advice to everybody is be more afraid not to go to the doctor.
There's a lot of fear about cancer and about breast cancer, and there are a lot of myths about it. So first of all, people think all cancer is fatal. If you get cancer, that's it, you're dead. So don't name it, okay? Don't claim it, don't name it. And that is unfortunate, because breast cancer is one of those things where you actually do want to find it before it finds you.
Particularly for women, we tend to be the caregivers of the family, and we'll put needs of our children, put everyone else's needs as a priority, and go to the doctor last ourselves. And so we'll make sure that our kids go to their pediatrician and get their vaccines, or if they have a cold or whatever, but we'll delay our own care, trying to take care of our family's needs.
If you take just what they give you, and just, you know, you may not get the best treatment plan, but because you ask questions and you're concerned and you ask about the medicine and they give you the best when you're concerned about yourself.
Keep living. You know, every time I want to feel sorry for myself, I see somebody out there and I say, you have nothing to complain about. You're out here every day, you're enjoying life. But you, like I said, you will have the scars, but it doesn't stop you.
Every day is a blessing, Kenya. After having breast cancer, I look at the sky looks bluer. I look at the rain looks wetter. I look at the colors, your red shirt is redder. I look at the grass is greener. I could laugh at things that wasn't funny before. I could eat food, and it tastes wonderful. Since then, life just has been a plus. There has been a bonus. A day in the life of breast cancer is a life extended.
Now to keep it.
You write
art. That's my one word, man. It's art.
It's an underrated form of art.
Gave me a voice in the city.
I would say relief.
Just art.
Some would say just expression. Some would say creativity. Some might say living. But really, for us, it's grounded in writing. We are writers. That's what we call ourselves. That's what we do. First of all, graffiti is a mark on a surface, right? Then the urban graffiti that we have experienced in the last 50 years that came from Philadelphia and New York City and other inner city areas was a venue for young people to express themselves through vandalism, putting their names up, getting props, recognition, and fame for that. And then once you have skills based on spray painting, then you could take it further. It was tagging that made it possible for me to learn how to paint a butterfly, right? Or to be able to paint any language. Because all languages are the same. They build on a line and on curves, right? So that means you could go anywhere in the world and paint if you know how to do graffiti. So back to the history of it, in Chicago, it had always been here, but in different forms. People used rollers and paintbrushes back in the day. Old school gangbangers, the OGs, used to use rollers to put their names up. When graffiti came from New York, then people began to use spray paint to put their names up. And then it evolved from the tag into the wild style lettering that we know of today and the productions that we paint.
You know, like when you were a kid growing up in Chicago during that time, and it's still like this today, I don't think that's changed so much. Like, you pretty much know which gang is in the neighborhood by looking at the walls. So what happened was that the gangsters were claiming neighborhoods, you know? And when New York City graffiti came about, it was all about getting out of your neighborhood. Like, you didn't want to be the guy that wrote his name all over your neighborhood. You wanted to be the guy that was writing your name all over the city.
It depends what you write, you know? Like, I guess if you write, like, gang signs or, you know, stuff like that, it does make it look bad. But, I mean, this is like drawings. It's art. I mean, look at that and look at this. It takes a lot of talent to do this.
The difference between gang graffiti and art graffiti is that gang graffiti is more vandalizing possession over territory, and it's not for any emotion into it. It's just saying, this is mine, this is who we are, you know, and it's vandalizing. You know, it has no feeling into it. It has no purpose.
One of the hugest, most beautiful things that ever happened to me was becoming a graffiti writer, because it got me off the block. I mean, a lot of the guys that I grew up with, a lot of guys that I was friends with from the time I was like 5, 6 years old, you know, they got caught up in that gang stuff, and they could not walk 3 blocks east, you know, west, north, south without fear of, you know, getting their head split open, right?
You know, our community here suffers, man, from segregation, from racist housing policies. That have made it so that ownership is difficult here, so there's too many dilapidated structures around. So what should you do with that? Just leave them brown or whack or, you know, damaged? No, we want to bring some color to it. So the objective is basically to bring color to the community and beautify and transform it by painting these walls.
Well, I see my man painting, it stuck out to me because, like I said, I really don't see this in my community a lot, especially from back in the days to now. But it's a new way to express yourself. It's hot. It stands out in the community. It makes you wonder, like, who did it and how could I get involved? So it's what's up, man. Hey, just picture brain. It actually makes you see that it's more out here than just partying for entertainment or to express yourself or gangs and drugs and all that. You can draw, you can do art around the community, express your feelings on the wall or something.
When we painted this wall, we had like 15 kids for a summer program, and we painted the largest mural in the city, but it was a graffiti production. It was all real graffiti, real burners, telling the truth. Like, we did the police officers, a pig, and, you know, chasing after kids and stuff. That really changed how I realized, like, man, this really affects our community in a positive way, because all those kids would go by and they'd be like, I painted that. This was my idea. This was my idea. And I was like, man, this is beautiful. I would like to do this more.
I think that if you know how to do art, do graffiti, then you should do it, because it's something that has to do with emotion, about how you feel, about how things are probably going in your life. Basically, if you use a dark color, that means something bad. If you use a light color, it means something good. I think art, graffiti, all that is just a fun thing to do. I mean, it doesn't matter what anybody thinks about graffiti or art.
Art graffiti is more of a, this is what the world is, this is what it has come to, this is what we're doing, and this is what we want. You know, it's just someone's feelings into a canvas and just showing that the world isn't right, or just showing how their mind is going. Something that can't be said and can't be understood and just seen through one's hands.
It's more like a type of expression, I would say. Yeah, like, you know, people have like certain ways of expressing themselves. Then we express ourselves through art. So it'd be like politics and art, let's say, go hand in hand, you know? It's like representing us and what we have to say. But we don't have a word, you know, they don't take our word, so might as well show them, right?
But you are gonna have a great day, dude.
just not even gonna worry about anything that's going on today, okay? Can be different for mama. Just have a great day.
Look at this girl come through this hallway with the rock of his fit off.
Everybody want to walk around and be followers and do the same thing. I choose not to. I'm one of the few, and I choose to be different.
I remember the days way back when I was a child. There was a monster in my closet. Scared to open the doors, afraid of what might be there. There was a monster in my closet. Like an evil monkey, he hunted me and watched my every move. Afraid to tell my mom what was going on, I sat back in silence. There was a monster in my closet. He only came out at night, afraid to show the sun his face. If he did, dogs would bark, birds would chirp, and sirens would sound. And then there was the darkness. There's a monster in my closet. Trying to run away, hiding under the covers, but nothing can stop him. I try to hide in his domain, but he has removed the door. So where will I go? There's a monster in my closet.
Sexual abuse is a major concern in America. This issue is affecting families across the nation.
It's a pretty prevalent issue. And I think what happens is that sometimes you see it being as a cycle. A lot of it comes from familial, meaning family issues. Usually the perpetrator is somebody who's lived in a household.
90% of child sexual abuse happens within with people you know.
I mean, I think that definitely at the root of child sexual abuse is a history of it. I think in a lot of different abuse, I see such a pattern of, well, this happened to me. You grow up, and even though you thought it was wrong as a child, it still is so ingrained in you. So I think definitely part of it is realizing that folks who are abused do need help.
Because the effects of childhood sexual abuse can be so hurtful, it is critically important that we try to find ways to stop abuse from happening.
When a child comes in, they may be acting up, they may be having difficulty in school, they may be withdrawing from family. There's maybe some suspicion that there's some stuff going on, but sometimes you don't know. And sometimes things that kids show in terms of reactions to sexual abuse looks like other things too. I mean, it could be other stuff going on in their life.
I mean, it ranges because working with teens versus working with children are different where they are developmentally. So the manifestations of child abuse can look different. The sexual child abuse looks different.
I didn't deal with my sexual trauma from childhood until I was an adult. But going to therapy, and particularly working with therapists, psychologists who specialize in sexual trauma, has been one of the most rewarding and most transformative experiences of my life.
My sister told me that she was sexually assaulted. I was the first family member that she told. And so in response to that, I didn't really know how to help her, as so many people, when they hear somebody that they've loved has been sexually assaulted. And she told me that she was sexually assaulted twice. My senior year, I made this big performance about my sister's healing process, using my own photographs from that initial story, me documenting her, and using music and art. And now me and my sister, we started a nonprofit together, and we've used that story, and we've gone to over 100 different colleges and universities, like talking about her healing process, but how to end sexual violence, which I think we often don't talk about, like the healing process. Sometimes we talk about the assault itself, but not how people have to put the pieces back together after something like that has happened.
Children who have been sexually abused face too much pain to bear the emotions by themselves.
Because children don't have this level of verbal sophistication that adults have, art therapy is one of the primary mediums to use with young people or young children because of their verbal ability, right? So a child might not be able to say how something makes them feel, but if you have them draw it and you talk about that, then you can get a lot of different ideas. And you can both diagnose children through that, but also help them heal.
As a diagnostic tool, it's helpful to watch what they do with their toys or in their art, if they do art therapy. In terms of treatment, a lot of times I've used puppets, you know, and kind of that's a safer way to kind of talk about things that are uncomfortable.
Usually it goes unnoticed because usually the victim is scared to even share what has happened. What happens, especially in the school system, you pick up on behaviors, whether it's the child or the adolescent, that gives you kind of a clue that something has happened, you know, that kind of opens up the doors to have further conversation about what may be triggering that child to have, you know, to behave in such a way.
If you're a young person and you haven't heard anyone else even mention that this is happening, you're probably feeling like you're the only person. So I think just getting awareness out, starting to talk about it, having a dialogue around these issues, and letting young people know this is not okay. If this is happening to you, you can come forward, you can talk about it.
We just have to start having these honest talks about it, right? Like, we have to break those silences. We have to believe survivors once they tell their stories about being sexually assaulted.
Schools and communities can build awareness for preventing child sexual abuse by talking about it and being able to have it not feel like it's something that is shameful, creating space for kids to go, whether it's groups, and not just that for survivors, I mean even just groups for kids who want to go and talk about something happening in their home.
Childhood sexual abuse isn't a topic that is often discussed, especially with children. In order to prevent childhood sexual abuse, children should be more aware and more knowledgeable about this topic.
I do think people's religious practices or their spirituality, however they choose to define it, can help them. I think friends and family can be a really important resource, and especially if the people believe them and are trusting and help them through their healing process. I think your community, however you describe it, but oftentimes friends and family, are the ones that can, and your therapist and your spiritual counselor can help you get through the trauma and somehow get through that process and come out on the other side and be someone that we call a survivor.
I'm gonna be turning all these heads at the game tonight. Shortybed.com.
75% of teenagers will have had sex by the time they are 20.
Girl, where you going? To the game. You like my makeup?
Yeah, I guess.
I'm gonna get too many shorties numbers tonight, man.
First of all, you got on too much makeup, and you need to get your priorities straight. Boys is not the only thing in life.
Girl, you tripping.
U.S. teenagers are more than likely to have sex before the age of 15.
This is the female student mentor class. I really think you would like it here. It's where girls help other girls build their self-esteem.
Every night she walks right in my dreams. Since I met her from the start, I'm so proud I am the only one who is special in her heart. The girl is mine. She's yours, not mine. Sending roses and
silly dreams really just a waste of time because she's mine.
FSM News is on.
Today at FSM News on the Roll, we are here at Oak Street Beach, and teens are trying to enjoy their last days of summer.
And it's almost time to go back to school. Here are some stories that can help you throughout the school year. Don't touch the remote. We will be right back.
Welcome to FSM News. I'm Ja'Kira Smith.
And I'm Kazi Ofel.
Not many students may have time to make breakfast on a school morning.
Or enjoy eating school lunch.
So many of them wait until they get home to eat, and this can leave them unfocused during the school day.
So, here's Precious Johnson with some tips on how to make your day better.
Summer's coming to an end. It's time to ditch the ice cream and get back into the school routine. But how? Because you got to know what you have to eat and what you can't eat. So let's go to Chef Aria for that information.
The problem with most kids and teens is that they don't have time to make a nutritious meal, so they either eat junk food or don't eat anything at all. I'm going to show you that it's not impossible to have a hearty breakfast ASAP. So now I'm going to start with something super simple. I'm going to take some toasted whole grain breakfast waffles and just take some hazelnut spread, or most people will notice as Nutella, and just take a good amount and spread it on both waffles. I'm substituting the hazelnut spread for the traditional syrup because it has a lot less fat and sugar. And so now I'm just going to take a small handful of dry cranberries and sprinkle that all over both waffles. And here is my super simple healthy breakfast.
Not all teens eat their school lunches, so here's Chef Aria with another treat.
I'm going to show you how to make a nice, healthy BLT. Everybody loves BLTs. And so we're going to start with the traditional BLT has mayonnaise, but for this we're going to use an avocado spread. I'm going to take some 100% whole grain bread and just spread that all over. And to add some flavor, so it's just not just plain avocado, I'm going to take some Italian seasoning, salt and pepper, and just do a few jet dashes. To have as a side, I'm going to have some pop chips. You could have a banana, and as a drink, just have like some regular water. And that is it for my super quick and simple healthy meals. These are awesome, and go ahead and try them at home because they're super quick and they're easy. And I hope you use these food tips for your up and coming school year. And now I'm going to hand it back to Precious.
Thanks, Aria. You learn something new every day. And don't forget to try these new tips. Reporting for FSM News, I'm Precious Johnson.
Thanks, Precious.
Man, I remember my freshman year. I wish someone was there to help me learn the ropes.
Yeah, me too. For you upcoming freshmen out there, pay close attention because here's some advice for you.
Going into high school, you want to be aware of the people you surround yourself with and the decisions you make.
I feel really excited, but at the same time, like, kind of scared, like, you know, as freshmen would be. But yeah, I'm really excited. I'm going to good school. We'll see how things goes, you know.
And make sure I do what's like most important fast, and then I try and like work out with my friends and stuff.
What advice would you give a freshman to excel academically?
I would say study a lot and always ask your teachers for questions.
As many know, staying on top of your work is very important.
My main focus when I was a freshman was to really get straight A's. I got close. I got 2 B's and the rest of them were A's. I could have studied more and procrastinated less. And I think it's easier if you kind of break things down and take the time to do everything separately.
Although freshmen should focus on their academics, they should still get involved with after-school activities.
Staying involved in activities that are school-related, going to football games and going to clubs and stuff like that, and just trying to hang around a good group of people. I was in baseball, wrestling, cross country, and then I was in National Honor Society, physics, and Latin club.
As upperclassmen reflect over their high school life, they leave a piece of advice for the newcomers.
Just try and stay involved in activities and, you know, meet as many people as you possibly can and stay active with your teachers so, you know, keep your grades up.
Just be friendly to people, and everyone else is nervous, so just be friendly, and like whatever you say to people, they'll be happy that someone's talking to them.
Reporting for FSM News, I'm Juwan Ross.
Kazio, do you manage your time before and after school?
Yep.
Well, for those who don't, you should watch this.
Time is a terrible thing to waste.
Wow, I can't believe the school year is already here. Jakira, what you do over the summer?
Oh, I did a little bit of everything. I went shopping, took a road trip to Memphis, and even had Gus's real famous chicken.
Oh, really? That's funny. I went to Memphis too.
Really?
Yep.
Well, here's Lindell Connor with more summer stories.
With the summer coming to an end and school right around the corner, I spoke to a few people about their experience during break.
This summer, I played with USA Volleyball. It's a pretty big deal, like in the volleyball world. Like, you get to try out, and you get to play with basically some of the best people in the country.
Just going to the beach a lot and having fun and just chilling out.
Although people are disappointed with going back to school early, they still have high expectations.
3.0 grade point average at least, and I also want to make the junior varsity volleyball team.
I want to get at least a 30 on my ACT because I have to take that this year, and I want to make U.S. volleyball again.
I want to keep my grades up and keep doing well in sports.
Students want to have a balance between their studies and extracurricular activities during the year.
Oh, I made a lot of new friends doing that, and so it makes school a lot better.
Play football and go to the pool a lot.
People enjoyed their current summers more than their previous summers.
Last summer, I didn't really do anything, and I was kind of, just bored.
More age freedom and stuff, and I've just been doing a lot more stuff with my friends and stuff, going to the pool, beach, stuff like that.
So there you have it. Hope everyone had a great summer. See you during the upcoming school year. Reporting for FSM News, I'm Lindell Connor.
Kazio, do you have any goals set for the upcoming school year?
Well, this year I was really hoping to become a ninja.
Are you serious?
Nah.
Well, for those who are indecisive, here's Martez Crosby with the goals that you might want to consider.
Did you know that the best way to be successful in school is to set new goals for the upcoming school year?
Good way to like put a certain where you want to be at the end of the school year and give yourself like somewhere to aim for.
If you don't really have anything, then you won't do as the best that you can.
Don't forget to keep your goals, and the best way to succeed starts with a smile.
I just keep working forward until I get it. But if I not, I try harder.
It's not too hard. You just have to keep doing what you're supposed to be doing and not slack or anything.
Just don't slack off, and mainly just try your best and keep up on your grades and homework and just turn it in.
Reporting for FSM News, I'm Martez Crosby.
Corner. We're here at the Magnificent Mile. With school right around the corner, it's time to start thinking about fall fashions. Describe what you have on today.
Well, I have on this white and black polka dot shirt. I got this from Forever 21. My pants are from the thrift store, actually, the Goodwill. And I don't remember where I got the sandals from. My bag from Forever 21 also. And my lips, Keisha Kayor.
Kind of got the idea from looking online, like news sites, stuff like that.
I just have like my Keds because they're comfy, and then high-waisted shorts from Wet Seal, a crop top from Express, and then this button-up shirt is from Wet Seal too.
Being in a big city like Chicago, people have very different preferences of what they like to wear. What is your go-to outfit for this season?
Mostly just leggings and like a longer dress shirt. It's just comfortable and easy to do stuff in.
For fall, skinny jeans, comfortable shoes, and then probably a short-sleeved shirt with a cute jacket.
Pretty much just like the hoodie sweatshirt kind of deal.
My go-to outfit would probably be something like I have on right now, either like a leather jacket or a denim jacket. Usually I just wear like t-shirts underneath.
With school and fall nearing, there will be new trends and clothes sold in stores. What trends do you expect to see in stores this upcoming season?
Well, I see a lot of the high-low type skirts and everything, so I think those will really be popular for back to school, definitely crop tops, and a lot of chunky jewelry. I think chunky jewelry is coming back for the fall.
More of a floral for guys especially, because like floral seems to be coming in. I'm looking forward to those floral Janowskis.
This fall, like three-button suits are going to be huge, a lot of fur stuff, and I think camo should still be pretty big, and like leather detailing.
So this fall, expect to see a mixture of all types of clothes, ranging from fun crop tops to furs to keep you warm on chilly days. Reporting from FSM News, I'm Anaja Smith.
Well, that's all for today, folks.
So we'll see you next time.
Until then, you can find more information about us on Facebook. Just search FSM News.
Or you can also find us on ABC7 Chicago's website in the community section.
And remember to look for us on CAN TV, channel 19 and 27.
3, 2, 1,
that's a wrap.
It's a tooth. Kazia, do you have any goals set for the upcoming school year?
Not really, just to become a ninja.
Really?
Are you serious?
Nah.
I can't hear you, boy. Say nah. Kazia, do you have any goals set for the upcoming school year?
Not really, just to become a ninja.
Kazio, do you have any goals set for the upcoming school year?
Not really, just to become a ninja.
Are you serious?
Nah.
He went too fast. Are you serious?
Nah.
Well, for those who are indecisive, here's Montez Crosby. Are you serious?
Nah.
Well, for those who are indecisive, here's Montez Crosby on... Are you serious?
Nah.
Well, are you serious?
Nah.
Are you serious?
Nah.
I keep looking at the camera right now. Are you serious?
Nah.
Are you serious?
Nah. I don't want to get them dirty.
I did it wrong again?
Yes.
How?
Oh, okay.
Are you serious?
Nah.
Well, for those who are indecisive, here's Montez Crosby with goals that you might want to consider.
She's gonna poke me.
Sorry.
Action in 3, 2.
Well, that's all for today, folks.
Free Spirit Media cultivates diverse youth voices to transform media and society.